Hello student, you are welcome to Study Good Academy. You are welcome to Data Processing class. Alright, Data Processing. Now the topic of today in this subject of Data Processing is digitalization of data. Digitalization of data. On this very lesson, at the end of my lesson, I would like you to be able to define digitalization of data. Alright? And you should be able to give various types of computers. Also, you should be, I'm expecting you, you're expected to be able to state the components of computer. Now, definition, digitalization. Digitalization is the process of converting, is the process, that's what we call digitalization, not digital, but digitalization is the process of converting information into formats, into digital formats. That is to say, the process of converting information into digital format is known as digitalization. Okay, this information may represent an object. It could be image, sound, document, or a signal, usually an analog signal. Okay, that are organized into discrete sets of its points or samples. So this is the binary data which computers and many devices with computing capacity such as digital camera and digital hearing aids can what? Can process. Alright, so also digitalization can be defined as an integration of digital technologies into everyday life. Okay, digitalization can be defined as the integration of digital technologies into everyday life. So here, modern cameras, television, phones, and computers are all examples of digital technology. Parallel to the digital system, most technologies run on the analog system. An analog system uses a continuous signal which varies in amplitude to represent a variable. Okay, such as voice or data, rather than having a limited range of steps like digital system. Alright, so a digital system uses a binary numeric system in which electronic pulses are represented by either 1 for a high pulse or 0 for a low pulse. That is why I normally tell people that zeros, or let me say ones and zeros. Okay. The language, we call it binary, in which computer understands. So digital systems can more easily represent symbols such as alphanumeric characters which represent real world data than the analog system. Okay, so let's move to history of computer development. That is the historical development of computer, how computer had developed. Okay, computers are machines which perform tasks or calculations according to a set of instructions or programs. Okay, so the first fully electronic computers was introduced in the 1940s. So the first fully electronic computers introduced in these 1940s were huge machines which required teams of people to operate. It could not be operated by a person or two, but a team, a group of people. Compared to those early machines, today's computers are amazing. Not only are they thousands of times faster than the previous, that the early machines, they can fit on your desk, in your lap, or even in your pocket. Unlike then, that a whole computer can occupy a whole house, a whole building, a whole room. Actually, electronic data processing does not go back more than just half a century. I mean, they have been in existence since early 1940s. In early days, when our ancestors lived in caves, counting was a problem. So when they started using stones to count their animals, all the possessions, they never knew that this would lead them to a computer of today. So people today started following a set of procedures to perform calculations with these tools, which later led to the creation of a digital counting device, which was the predecessor of the first calculating device invented as Habakkuk. Okay, as Habakkuk. Was the first calculating device that was invented. Remember I said that the first computers was introduced in 1940s. I may ask you this at any time. Okay. Now, let's move to the types of computers. There are types of computers that are available. The following are the types of computer. We have microcomputers. We have mini computers. We have mainframe computers. And we have supercomputers. Okay, so I'll be taking them one after the other for you to understand. Let me start with microcomputers. Microcomputers are the most common types of computers that are used by people today, whether in a workplace, at school, or on the desks at home. They are the smallest class of computers. Okay, take note of that. Microcomputers are the smallest class of computers. That's part of characteristics, the features of microcomputers. Okay. They are the smallest. I said they are the smallest class of computers. Okay. So the term microcomputer was introduced with the advent of single chips microprocessors, which means that they use microprocessors. Okay, they use single chips microprocessor. So it uses single microprocessor mounted with memory chips as its central processing unit. That central processing unit that I just said, thanks my colleague, might refer to it as CPU. So these computers include, that is, the computer that falls on these microcomputers are desktop computers, games, consoles, laptops, notebooks. These are examples of microcomputers. Okay, notebooks, notebooks, computer, and tablet computer. Okay. Then that one, another example of this is smartphones. Smart books. Okay. And PDAs. That is, let me write it. Personal digital, okay, assistance. PDA means personal digital assistance. All right. So we have programming. programmable calculator. And we have another one that is called handheld game consoles. Okay. Consoles. So these are examples of microcomputers. Okay. So these are microcomputers we are talking about. These are the examples of them. You can see laptop. Those, all of them, these are examples. All what I mentioned there are inside these pictures. Okay. So let's move to the next type of computer, which is mini computer. Okay, mini computers. Mini computers, this is a class of multi-user computers that lies in the middle range of the computing spectrum, in between the smallest multi-user system, that is the mainframe computers, and the largest single-user system, which is the microcomputers, okay, or personal computers even. So they are large in size. Mini computers, they are large in size and in storage capacity. Typically, before I move on, this is one of the characteristics. They are large in size. Okay. They also have large storage capacity. Okay, so typically, mini computer have been a standalone computer. What I mean here is their computer system with attached terminals and other devices sold to small and medium size just for general business. They are meant for general business applications and to large enterprises for department level operations. So it has become a useful tool in the networking environment. Okay, so this is how mini computers look like. Okay, let me go to mainframe. Computers. Mainframe computers was created to distinguish the traditional large institutional computer intended to service multiple users from the smaller single user machines. So these computers are capable of handling and processing very large amounts of data. Okay, they are capable of handling and processing large amount of data rapidly, as in quickly. So mainframe computers are used in large institutions such as governments, such as banks and large corporations. So they are measured in MIPS, that is in millions instructions per second, and respond to up to 100 seconds of millions of users at a time. Okay, within seconds. So they make use of magnetic disks for mass data storage purposes. Okay, let me give you the diagram. Okay, so this is an example of mainframe computers. So now let's move on to supercomputer. Now I'm picking them one after the other. Supercomputers. A supercomputer performs at a speed which is far above that of other computers. It is focused on performing tasks involving intense numerical calculations, such as weather forecasting. Okay, we use it to forecast weathers, such as fluid dynamics, such as nuclear simulations, such as theoretical astrophysics, and complex scientific computations. Alright, they are used by scientists, large businesses, and metrologists, and etc. Okay, so a supercomputer is a computer which is at the front line of current processing capacity, particularly speed of calculations. So the time supercomputer itself is rather fluid, and the speed of today's supercomputers tends to become typical of tomorrow's ordinary computer. So supercomputer processing speeds are measured in floating points operations per second, or FLOPS. Okay, an example of a floating point operations is the calculation of mathematical equations in real numbers. So in terms of computational capability, memory size and speed, okay, input output technology and memory size and speed, topological issues such as bandwidth with latencies, supercomputers are the most powerful, are very expensive, are not cost effective just to perform batch of transaction processing. Okay, so on this, transaction processing is handled by less powerful computers such as server computers or mainframes. Okay, now like you to move to components of computer. Okay, component of computer. Here I said this classic computer have briefly described. Let me describe them for you, because each component is discussed in more details in its own sections. Let me draw something for you. This is representing memory. Okay. This is control. Okay. This is data path. Okay. This is input. This is output. All right. So there is a flow here from data path to control, from control to data path, from memory to the data path, from data path into the memory. Okay. Input to the memory, memory to the output. Okay, this is all is called. So the operation of the process, of the processor rather, is best understood in terms of this component I've drawn on the screen for you. Okay, this is what we call components, okay, or computer. Okay, of computers. So the first, let me take them one after the other. Let me start with data part. This for explanation. Data path, this manipulates, okay, the data. The data coming through the processor. That is this work. It manipulates the data coming through the processor. Okay. So it also provides a small amount of temporary data storage. So the data part consists of some components. The data part itself subcontains, or let me say it consists of some subcomponents, which are. Inside the data part, we are going to see what we call programmable. Okay. Programmable register. Okay. The program. We have program counters. Which is otherwise known as PC. We have multiplexers. We have processing elements. Okay. And I think we have special purpose. Okay. So, programmable register, small units, is a small unit of data storage that are directly visible to assembly language programmers. They can be used, or they are usually used, like simple variables in a high level programs. Okay, now the program counters, this holds the address for fetching instructions. Okay, it's usually used the address of fetching instructions. the multiplexers, okay, has multiplexer have control input coming from control. They are usually used for routing data through the data path. The processing elements compute new data values from old data values. So, in simple, processors, the major processing elements are grouped into an arithmetic logic unit, which is otherwise known as ALU. So, the last but not least, which is special purpose register, okay, that can be found in the data part, holds data that is needed for processor operation but is not directly visible to assembly assembly language programmers. Okay, so let's take, we have explained on this control. Okay, processing elements. Okay, I've not talked on the multiplex. I said it have, okay, I've talked on it, processor, processing element. Processing element is this compute new data values from old data values. Okay, it's simple processor. Okay, I've talked about this also. Sorry. I've not talked about which is special purpose register. Special purpose registers hold data which is needed for processor operation. This is not directly visible to assembly language programmers. Okay. So which is control, control, okay, control control generates okay This generates control signals which direct the operation, okay, of memory. And the data part. Okay, so control tells memory to send or receive data. Okay, it also tells the ALU. It tells the ALU, that is the arithmetic logic unit, what operation to perform. It also routes data between different parts of the data path. Number three, which is memory, I'm analyzing the components of computer. Okay, memory. This holds, memory holds instruction. Okay, and most of the data okay for currently programs. Okay, let me Let me see for correcting, for currently executing programs. Okay, so the rest of the data is held in programmable registers, which can only hold a limited amount of data. So, input. External devices input is such as keyboards, mice, disks, and networks that provide input to the processor. So in modern processors, this data is placed in memory before entering the processors. Okay, input handling is largely under the control of operating system software. The fifth one, which is the last but not the least, okay, these are external devices such as displays, printers, disks, and networks that receive data from the processor. Alright, so in modern processors, this data is placed in memory before leaving the processor. Output handling is largely under the control of operating system software. Okay, and then talk about system unit. The system unit is the core of a computer. Okay, system unit is the core of a computer. So usually it is a rectangular box placed on or underneath your desk. So inside this box are many electronic components that process information. So the most important of this component is the central processing unit that is called CPU or microprocessor, which acts as the brain of the computer. Another component is random access memory, okay, which temporarily stores information that the CPU uses while the computer is on. So the information stored in RAM is erased when the computer is turned off. What I'm trying to say in essence here in the system unit is that in the system unit, okay, okay, it can get there we have CPU, which is the central processing unit. Inside it we have RAM, okay, which is the random access memory. So here going to end the lesson. Okay, thank you for being attentive. Thank you for the audience given. Before I move out, I will like you to do this. 1. Define digitalization of data. 2. On your own, explain the issue of computer development. On your own, state the components of computer. And on your own, without looking the screen, I want you to state types of computer. Thank you very much. Have a wonderful day.